here because I believe I found my vocal compass. I was told as a child that I'm God's special child. Never truly understood this, the meaning of this reference until I actually grew up. Growing up with disability, I thought that this is something people said to compensate for the lack of normalcy in my life. But as life progressed, I understood what it actually is. I realized that I'm not different from the people around me, but I'm definitely special. So I was born as one of the twins, and I was born with the umbilical cord around my neck. This damaged a part of my brain, confining me to the wheelchair. But as a child, I always had a very different perspective of disability. I thought it was something that would fade away as I grew. With time, I realized what it actually is, and I was blessed with the ability to accept the same and live a life closer to normal. My family had a great role to play in this. They did everything they could to give me a normal childhood, which is why probably I have memories of playing in the mud and also painting more on myself than on the paper. Physiotherapy was a great part of my treatment. With all the pain, I actually dreaded the presence of a physiotherapist in my life. But nonetheless, we continued that, and it is what made me what I am today. The only difference is that I did not go to school in the initial years of my life because I had to devote it to treatment. But despite that, my sister would go to school and teach me whatever she had learned. This way, we created a world of our own, but I didn't really feel the lack of learning. And so as I grew, and I realized that I needed more medical support, and we flew to the US along with my mom. We stayed there for 9 months, and I had a variety of treatments and surgeries, but I recollect this time as the loneliest of all, because this was the first time I was away from my protected world and from my sister on whom I depended so much. But we had to go through this, and this is the time I actually coped with my loneliness by talking to an imaginary friend. You could call me a mad girl in the whole country at that point in time. But I returned with the ability to walk with support. That was a great change in my life. When I returned, I saw a great difference between the two countries and their approach towards disability. For instance, I could probably go on a school in the United States or take a bus to some place. But in India, this is something I cannot expect to do, at least not yet. But someday, I hope we will develop enough to be able to make the disabled community a little more mobile than it is. When I came back, I joined school, a very normal school, like my mom insisted, and progressed through it. Throughout school, I believed that I was an average student. I never really got a chance to explore my talents then. But it was only after school that I realized that I could be among the toppers and even do better than people around me. So before I could go to college to explore that, I faced my first big challenge. I realized that not many colleges are happy to accept a person with disability. I did not really understand why, but when I finally approached a popular college in the city to study there, I was told that they do not want to have me because I need to use their lift, and which was apparently only meant for their staff. My family and I didn't really understand this rejection. I mean, what's the big deal in using a gift? But anyway, we moved on to another college. But before we could do that, my sister and my mom insisted that we should bring this to the notice of people through a newspaper article. I wasn't sure if we should do that because I thought it would work against my career, and maybe no other college will hire me. But we went ahead anyway, and then I realized that it was the best thing to do. It is my right to study in any college that I want, and no college can deny me this right with the good scores. So by putting this in the newspaper, I thought that everybody should be aware of this right and nobody should be left unheard. Through this process, I learned that I was not the only one in this struggle. There are many such people who are actually struggling in this aspect but are waiting to be heard. I was hoping that by giving it in the newspaper, I'd give some people some strength to speak for themselves. I finally got into a college and finished my graduation. But that was not it. Finding good schools and colleges was not the end of the struggle for me. To write my exams, I realized that I need a scribe to write for me because I can't write at the pace of the other people do. But each scribe gave me a different experience. Sometimes the scribe did not know the language or the handwriting was not legible. In any case, I thought I was losing out on a lot of time and I had to compromise on the quality of my answers. I felt that it was unfair that I cannot express myself only because I can't write by myself. So when my mom, she went ahead and explained this to the examiner there, he gave me the shock of my life. He asked her why she was so keen when people with disability barely pass because of their limited intelligence. After being surrounded by positive thoughts and people, this was my first time hitting the harsh reality. I did not know how to react. But today, when I think of this, there's a song that comes to my mind. It goes, "You made me insecure. You told me I wasn't good enough. But who are you to judge when you're a diamond in the rough? I'm sure you've got some things you'd like to change about yourself. But when it comes to me, I wouldn't want to be anybody else." So after that, I continued through college and it was time for me to find a job. Once again, I thought no employer would probably be interested in hiring me because of the limited knowledge of my disability, which is hard to explore within a few minutes of an interview. But I got lucky once again. So I got into an immigration and visa company who was happy to hire me as a content writer there. So first time, somebody was happy to look beyond my disability. So I worked there for 7 months, and when it was time for me to leave that place, it was decided that I should give my friends a treat. So this day became a turning point in my life, which I never expected. At that point, lunch was ordered and everybody went away to the dining hall. But one friend of mine was waiting. He said, "Come, let's go." And I said, "Hey, why don't you go with the others? I'll finish up my work and come." He said, "How will you come?" And at that second, I realized that I wasn't able to go by myself. I realized that throughout this time, I had forgotten about my disability. The people around me made me feel so normal that I could completely ignore my disability. This is definitely a turning point in my life. I'm not sure if I could really define the broken compass, but I do know that I have found my strength, and I'll never give up. I've become a believer who knows that she'll find a way no matter what. I'd like to take this opportunity to urge parents of people with disability to please send your kids to schools and colleges and inspire them to lead a normal life. Because inclusion begins at home. Thank you very much.